So Enter the Matrix is a video game in the Matrix franchise that was in development as the Matrix sequels were being made. In fact, 1 hour of footage was filmed for the game while the sequels were filming. It was released on the same day as The Matrix Reloaded, in fact. It was also the most expensive video game ever made at the time, with a budget of $20 million. The game actually did sell very well, with a total number of 5 million copies. However, the game received many negative reviews from pretty much everyone. Most of the complaints were about the gameplay mechanics and how clunky they were. After Max Payne, many people were excited about a Matrix game being made, but it appears it ultimately had diminishing returns. But the game is almost 16 years old now, so I thought I'd take a look back and see if it's as bad as everyone says. There may also be an appearance by someone you know. Alright. So the game starts off with a cutscene with Ghost and Sparks talking about stuff.
We didn't have a lot of time.
A lot of time? Wrong, we don't have a little time.
They're talking about an objective they need to accomplish regarding the post office, and then we get Niobe doing Niobe face. One thing I should mention is that the game takes place during the events of Matrix Reloaded, which is really weird in the way it's presented. Like, the game will skip huge chunks of the story, which means that at times you have no idea what's going on, unless you're watching the movie as you're playing the game, and even then that's a very weird way to experience a story. The opening to this game is pretty boring, to be honest. I mean, let's compare this to how the first two movies opened. The first Matrix starts off with a quick conversation about the plot in a mysterious fashion that gives the viewer questions about what's going on, similar to how Neo has questions as to what's going on, and has a cool chase sequence across rooftops. The Matrix Reloaded starts off with a cool action sequence and then a brief exposition scene explaining the plot. And now the pace of The Matrix Reloaded is all over the place, but it does open in a way that grabs your interest and introduces the plot and characters. Here, the characters have weird-ass conversations about the mission they're trying to accomplish, which we have no actual idea of and is not explained in the game, but is explained in the movie and the Animatrix.
You got 10 minutes until the
post office closes. There's a ton of heat in the area, but the package is still untouched. The box number is 731222.
Got it.
I'm sorry, why are we going to the post office? Like, unless you've seen the film, you won't know what's going on, or what the package is, or why you're getting it. Anyway, you get to choose whether to play as Ghost or Niobe, which sounds like it might be fun, right? Two different perspectives on the same story? How awesome will that be? It sucks. There is barely any difference between the two campaigns aside from some extra missions and some slightly different cutscenes and some slightly different dialogue. What's the point then? Why not just have a campaign where you switch sides throughout? Let's also address the elephant in the room. No, you don't get to play as Neo. Which nowadays isn't a huge issue since Path of Neo exists where you actually get to play as Neo, but back in 2003 people were hoping for a Matrix game where you get to play as the main character from the films. Neo is in the game for two camera shots. The first one is reused footage from The Matrix Reloaded, and the second being a shot where Neo is just in the corner. Keanu Reeves is even credited as Neo in the credits despite being in the game for less than 30 seconds total. Morpheus is also barely in the game, which is even more disappointing considering how underutilized he was in the sequels. Luckily, Trinity does get a fair amount of screen time, and there's even a sparring section with her, so at least one of the three OG got a fair amount of screen time. Look, I know this isn't a story about Neo or Morpheus or Trinity, but they're the main characters of the franchise, and they appear for seconds at most. That's a disgrace. Anyway, since there is barely a difference between both campaigns, I'll cover them as one campaign and point out when there are differences. So they arrive at the post office, and you walk in as whoever you're playing as. Okay, having to refer to both characters constantly is going to be annoying. So I'll name the character as X, unless I'm referring to something which only happens in their campaign, in which I will actually name the character. X then enters the post office, and this is where I get into the gameplay of Enter the Matrix. So Enter the Matrix's combat is heavily inspired by the films, obviously, and the motion capture and overall animations are supposed to emulate that style, but it didn't lead to very good gameplay. I don't know where to start here. Okay, the camera is a pain in the ass. Whenever you engage in hand-to-hand combat, the camera does like this close-up lock-on on the enemy First, this sucks because it means you can only engage enemies in combat one at a time, or at least it's inconvenient if you're fighting a group of enemies and are trying to fight them at once. It also does make the game feel much more claustrophobic and thus doesn't allow much room for maneuverability. There also isn't that many moves or combos the player can use. Sometimes the character will just jump off a wall and attack the enemy, but that's about it. They also do try to emulate the shoot dodge from Max Payne, but it's way too overpowered and makes the game way too easy. Plus, you can change direction mid-air, like, what the fuck? That just makes the game horribly unbalanced. The controls also suck 10 dicks, as they feel clunky as hell. I know it's hard to explain how something feels, but it feels like the characters are delayed a bit from the player's actions. Like, you'll press the jump button, but instead of jumping instantly, they'll jump like half a second later. Same with pretty much every other mechanic in the game. It makes it feel unresponsive. There are often times where the game will mistake in your input for something else, and thus the game will punish you for its mistakes. That wouldn't be an issue if you didn't die in 3 seconds, but you do in this game. Even on normal difficulty, you can die in less than 2 seconds from regular gunfire, which wouldn't be a problem if it wasn't for the clunky and unresponsive controls. Meaning that most of the time, your death in this game isn't your own fault, but it's just the game being a dipshit. Speaking of which, let's talk about the shooting. The game has auto-aim. Auto-aim in a PC shooter! Now for consoles it does make sense to have auto-aim, but for PC, what the fuck? Just let me aim where I want to. There is no skill required in aiming, as you can just snap to targets and kill them instantly. Plus the auto-aim fucks up constantly and will aim for an enemy you don't want to shoot at. Sometimes it will even ignore enemies right in front of you, or aim at stuff in the environment instead of the enemies. Why? I can tell you why the game was rushed. There are different types of guns, like pistols, shotguns, machine guns, and snipers, but why are there like a million different pistols, shotguns, machine guns, and snipers? They all act the same way and all serve the same purpose, so what's the point in having a fucking million different versions of them? There's also a fucking cover mechanic, but it's pointless. Like, you just pop out and the auto-targeting system has a 50-50 chance of working? Why would anyone play the game like this? The level design is also boring and repetitive. There is some stuff like the airport or the chateau level from Matrix Reloaded, or even the highway chase from Matrix Reloaded, but most levels you're just in sewers or industrial facilities and it gets old really, really fast. There are also driving levels where you play as Niobe and you can drive the car, and the controls are terrible and the car has way too much traction on it. When you play as Ghost, you shoot out the car while Niobe's terrible AI rams the car into several walls. And that's about it for the gameplay. This isn't a game like Max Payne 3 where it has minor issues throughout the game that add up to a very unpleasant experience. It's a game with a couple massive flaws. The gameplay is unbalanced, repetitive, clunky, poorly designed, and is overall a complete mess and fails to capture the spirit of the fights in the films. But alright, I guess let's get onto the fucking story or something, I don't know. Ah, fuck, let's get this over with. So, after arriving at the post office, you get a package. What does the package contain? Well, you don't even know if you watched the movie. The game never tells you, so if you haven't seen the movie, then this level means fuck all. X then jumps out the window as Y comes to save them. Niobe and Ghost then drive off. If you're playing as Niobe, you have to deal with a shitty driving section, and if you're playing as Ghost, you have to deal with the aforementioned shit. They then both crash and X has to make it to a phone, but then an agent comes out of nowhere, just like the films, and then you have to run away to the same spot and escape. When you put this level in the context of the whole franchise and the story, it is important, but you would only know the context behind this level if you've seen Matrix Reloaded. So they deliver the information to Commander Locke, and then get a level of Ghost and Niobe at the airport, trying to save Axel. Whoever the fuck he is, he never does anything again in the entire fucking franchise, so why in fucking hell did this level fucking exist? If you play as Niobe, you have to go through a underground tunnel, and then through some airplane hangars, and then board an airplane with Axel on it, and kick an agent out the plane, and then parachute out. And if you're playing as Ghost, you have to fight through a terminal and a helicopter, and then shoot out a plane tires, and then fight another helicopter, and then there's a fucking driving section where you follow the airplane, and then the car, and it's fucking terrible, and it's shit, I wanna kill myself, what the fuck were they thinking? And then both characters head to the fucking meeting scene from the beginning of Matrix Reloaded, and it's edited down quite a bit for some reason. to the point where there's no Neo and Morpheus is only in one fucking shot. Then there's a boring ass fucking sewer level that goes on forever, and it's the exact same series of levels for both characters. What a bunch of lazy assholes. Then the Keymaker comes out of nowhere because the Wachowskis wrote themselves into a corner. The Keymaker is then supposed to give them a key, but fucking Cain and Abel come through and steal the key, which means you have to chase after them through the chateau, which may be the only bearable level in the game, but even then, this is just filler and not very fun filler at that. But then Y gets captured, which means X has to go save them. They then meet Persephone, and Persephone asks them for a kiss, and they kiss it. Which means that we do get some girl-on-girl action here if you're playing as Niobe. Anyway, X and then finds Y, and then they get out of the chateau. But then they run into twins, and the character models look awful. In fact, all the character models in this game look awful. Max Payne 2 released only 4 months after this game and had better character models. And it didn't even have half the fucking budget. Then you engage in a terrible chase sequence with them and escape. Ghost then gets a fight with Trinity, and it's cool to see the characters interact, but that's about it. There's also a funny joke here about masturbation.
When are we gonna find you a girlfriend?
Like Augustine, I'm dedicated to a higher purpose.
What's that?
Onanism.
Is that why so many saints are blind?
Celibacy is a hands-on job.
Yes, a masturbation joke in a Matrix game. I never thought I'd see that. They then jump back into the Matrix and engage in the Highway Chaser in the Matrix Reloaded and save Morpheus, just like in the movie. Neo then comes in to save Morpheus and the Keymaker, so I guess Neo is technically in the game. My oh my, I'm a fucking moron. Then Niobe goes to head to the power plant to blow it up, and once again, you won't understand any of this shit if you haven't seen the fucking movie, but okay. This scene took up 10 seconds in the actual film, whereas here it's an overly long and boring level. And then you thought that would be the final level, right? Nope. X then goes to Seraph and fights him. If you beat him, you go to meet the Oracle. And then there's a chase sequence with Smith that goes on forever. And then you end it back on the Icarus, or whatever the fuck it's called. If you fail to beat him, then you just immediately get sent back to the Logos. Oh, it's the Logos. Which contradicts what happens in the third movie, but okay. Then the final level is just you fighting machines until Ghost and Niobe use the EMP on the ship and take out the machines, as then we get, and the game ends as we get a teaser for Matrix Revolutions.
Mr. Anderson, welcome back.
It ends tonight.
Neo.
He fights for us.
Like, to be honest, the main issue of this story is that there's fuck all going on in it, and that's why I summed up the entire story so quickly. Literally, it's very uneventful. Very uneventful. Really, the only levels that serve any importance is the first level in the office, the highway chase, and the power... Fucking power plant level. Can't pronounce it correctly. Jesus Christ, what the fuck is this game? Literally, any other level in the game is just filler, and it adds nothing, and it doesn't develop the characters, and it doesn't expand the story of the films in any interesting way. It's annoying. Another thing that is missing from the game is the philosophy that was explored in the films. As you know, the Matrix films explore interesting philosophies about life, control, purpose, choice, reality, you know, all that shit. It makes these films some of the most interesting action movies to watch. There's no philosophy in this game whatsoever, though. If I sound like I'm fucking bored or I'm not interested in doing this video, it's because I'm not. I'm just doing it because I feel obligated to, because it's Enter the Matrix and I'm going to be doing the whole Matrix saga. Literally, the only reason I'm doing this review is out of obligation. I don't give two shits about this game. I don't know why they didn't do any philosophy in this game, since there were plenty of games that did philosophy in them before this game released, such as System Shock, Metal Gear Solid, Deus Ex, and the Max Payne games, which I will admit, they aren't philosophy-heavy games, but it does show that exploring philosophy wasn't an alien concept to video games. Plus, it relies on you watching The Matrix Reloaded in order to understand this game. A story should be self-contained. Yes, I know you wanted the story in this game to tie in with the movie, but when you rely on the movie as your framework, then you fucked up. Both the game and the movie should be separate properties that tie in with each other, but can stand on their own two legs. The Matrix Reloaded can stand on its own two legs. Yeah, there are some things that are better explained in the game, and also better explained in the Animatrix, but ultimately you can watch the movie and understand the story just fine. But I thought for once, I would try and incorporate a different perspective in my video. To do this, I have brought on another Matrix fan who has been featured on my channel before. And I've been featured on his. I welcome the holder of the Infinity Stones, Baggy Spartan 117. Take it away, Baggy.
Thank you, Mr. No Life. During the early 2000s, I was introduced to The Matrix through The Matrix Reloaded. It was actually one of my favorite movies growing up, and I just really liked the action sequences, the visual effects, and the story that was presented to me. One of the things I really liked about Enter the Matrix was the gameplay. The gameplay was fast, relatively fluid, aside from a few janky animations and some terrible hit detection. The gameplay was fun, and it gave you a really incredible feeling of empowerment. The bullet time was really fun to use, especially with all the crazy stunts that you can do, and especially with the guns that you could use as well. The hand-to-hand combat was alright, but the only problem was there wasn't really enough variety to keep it really interesting. A lot of the time, she's just doing the same animations over and over again. And it would have really been nice if they added a lot more variety, maybe even some sort of small skill tree. One of the aspects that I actually really enjoyed about Enter the Matrix was the atmosphere. You really did feel like you were part of the universe that the Matrix films had presented for the past couple of years, and it was really engrossing. In fact, one of the things I remember very fondly about this game was the chateau level. The levels as a whole actually reminded me a lot of the Spencer Mansion from the Resident Evil games. It had this weird, dark, gothic atmosphere about it that was just really fun around to experience, and especially the music that played. A lot of the time it's very ambient, you hear a lot of weird, creepy noises, and especially there's a part where you hear a guy playing a piano. It's very haunting. In fact, going to the music as a whole is really badass. It does feel very Matrix-like, and in fact, they actually use some of the songs from The Matrix Reloaded, but they do add a few new tracks to, you know, let the game stand on its own 2 feet without completely copying from the 2 movies from before. Another interesting thing about this game is that it allowed you to play 2 playable characters, Ghost and Niobe, each having their own different stories and paths that are different from each other. The interesting character out of the two is Ghost, mainly because he is the more mysterious character of the Matrix films as a whole, and he has a really cool conflict within him, mainly because he has a lot of affection for Trinity, and he knows that he cannot love her because she is already in love with Neo. That's not to say Niobe is a terrible character, because she actually does have some of the better levels in the game where the AI doesn't fuck up as bad, but I've always enjoyed Ghost over Niobe pretty much every time I play this game, so I always pick Ghost. Another feature that a lot of people don't talk about in this game is that there is in fact a hidden 2-player mode, very similar to games like Mortal Kombat or Street Fighter, where you get to play as the Matrix characters, such as Morpheus, Trinity, pretty much everyone except from Neo, because for some reason the Wachowskis just didn't want to add Neo into this game for whatever fucking reason. But one of the funniest things about this 2-player mode is that there is a part where you can play as 2 Transformer-esque cars and beat the ever-living shit out of each other. And this was one of the most memorable parts about this game, especially playing with friends and family. That's not to say this game is perfect. As much as I would like this to be the perfect Matrix game, this really isn't. This game has a lot of fucking issues, both visually and technically as well. The character models, at least for the main 2 characters, look good, but when it comes to the enemy characters, they just look bland and pretty much boring. There's nothing really to make them distinct, and in fact there are downright fucking clones in this game, which doesn't help at all. In fact, the graphics as a whole are actually kind of lackluster. From what I remember, I do remember this game having pretty good graphics, but as time has gone on, the game has really showed its age, and this game doesn't look as good as it used to be. It's incredibly dark, you can barely see fuck all, to the point where you'd have to turn up the brightness, which can totally ruin your experience thanks to the brightness as a whole. And yeah, the game just isn't really pretty to look at. The game actually is really short for a Matrix game, especially with so much hype built around it. The game can roughly take you around 4 to 5 hours to complete, and that's for both campaigns. And for the asking price when this game came out, that's really just shitty in general. If this game was a little bit longer with a lot more content added to the story, maybe some new gameplay mechanics, then yeah, I think the price would have been justified. But as it stands, as of right now, nearly 20 years after it's released, nah, I don't think this game should have been £50 when it first came out. The game is really repetitive as well. A lot of the times you're just running around, pretty much doing nothing. The only interesting thing you'll be doing throughout the entire game is just either shooting people or running across the occasional agent. Despite all this game's problems, I still really enjoyed this game. If only they added a few more touches here and there just to improve the gameplay and improve the graphics and maybe some of the story elements, this game would have been a blast to play. And it still is to some extent, but not to the full potential that everyone back then wanted it to be. The game ain't perfect, but it's a lot better than Sonic 06, I can tell you that.
No, I 100% disagree with you, Baggy. I think this game is complete and utter fucking shit. Conclusion. So in conclusion, Enter the Matrix is a fucking terrible game. Broken ass gameplay mechanics, boring and eventful story, repetitive fucking everything, visuals, combat, dialogue, story, and overall it's just not that fun a game. But hey, at least they would make up for it with Path of Neo. But I'll talk about that in good time. In the meantime, this is where I get off.
Asking price of 50 quid. Jesus Christ. 50 fucking quid. No. Fuck no. This game should have been 30 quid. fucking 50 quid? You can suck my massive British penis.
What the fuck?
Oh, fucking hell. 50 quid! 50 quid broken ass game that I like. This is worse than Sonic 06, man. At least with Sonic 06 it had characters that you actually gave a shit about. Oh, and Sonic dies, let's not forget that fucking wasted potential. Fuck emotional storytelling, even though there wasn't any emotional connection to the characters way before that fucking incident. Oh. Okay.